HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Bravelands, Curse of the Sandtongue, The Venom Spreads, by Erin Hunter, performed by James Fouhey. Prologue. The sun sparkled on the surface of the watering hole as Gorge the crocodile gently let the top of her head break through the water. She opened her eyes just a fraction. Perfectly hidden, the ridged brown skin of her forehead camouflaged among reeds and broken twigs, she splayed her legs and floated, gazing at the bank where a zebra herd had gathered to drink. The world above the water was hot and bright, and even through the water, she could hear the thumping of the zebra herd's hooves as they drank. It wasn't hard to choose her prey, a zebra foal, drinking deeply some way from the rest of the herd. As she watched, it flicked its ears, which were still too big for its head, and one of its clumsy hooves slipped a little on the sandy bank. A quiet croak of satisfaction escaped Gorge's throat as a stream of tiny bubbles. These grass tongues, who ran in big, noisy herds, never taught their young to survive the way they should. The foal would be an easy target for hungry crocodiles, and the herd would run at the first sign of trouble, abandoning one to save the rest. She glanced from side to side, trying to pick out any competition, but she couldn't see a single one of her basque, neither the bumps of their foreheads above the water, nor the telltale dark shapes moving beneath it. She felt no stirring currents along her flanks. She narrowed her eyes. Surely she couldn't be the only one to have spotted this easy meal? She sank down under the water and used her tail to glide toward the spot on the bank, peering around through the silt and reeds as she went. Perhaps Feast or Writhe was hiding down there, biding their time and planning to ambush any other crocodiles who came near. It wouldn't be unusual for a fight to break out between them over a juicy morsel like this. Gorge had won and lost plenty of them in her time, and she had the scars to prove it. But there was still no sign of the basque. Even as the water grew shallower and the ripples from the foal's lapping tongue passed over Gorge's head, she floated to a stop, holding tense and still, until she saw the shadow of a muzzle descend and touch the surface. Then, with a powerful thrust and a thrash of her tail, Gorge reared out of the water, her jaws wide. She saw it all, in a bright flash, the endless blue sky above, the rolling, terrified eye of the young zebra, the panicking and prancing of its kin, the mud kicking up under their hooves as they scrambled away. The foal's legs shuddered and slipped in the muddy bank, too frightened to stay still, too shocked to get away. Gorge's jaws closed over its haunch. She heard the scream and tasted blood, then simply let the weight of her muscular body drag her and her prey back and down into the water. The zebra flailed as she pulled it under, bleeding and thrashing, sending up a curtain of bubbles and churning silt. Gorge simply waited. She had learned from her own mother, as all crocodiles did, that this was the grass tongue's final trick. Clever crocodiles wouldn't fall for it. They wouldn't try to move or finish their prey quickly, no matter how it wriggled. They would be patient and strong and wait for the spirit to leave so that the prey could become meat, fit for eating. Once her jaws were clamped shut, nothing would open them. The biggest risk now was not that the prey would escape, but that the other crocodiles would try to snatch it from her. She glanced around her, but again, there was a strange emptiness to this part of the watering hole. Where were the others? They couldn't have failed to notice the disturbance in the water, could they? The zebra twitched in her grasp, but weakly. Soon the water would flood its airways and it would be over. And still, there was no sign of the others. "They have come to me, child," said a deep, echoing voice. Gorge jumped and gave a great swipe of her tail to spin herself around in the water, though she had to drag the still twitching zebra along with her. But there was no one behind her. And indeed, she realized, the voice hadn't come from behind her. It seemed to resonate through the water, or perhaps just inside her own head. "Let go of the grass eater, my love," said the voice. It spoke sand tongue, but it didn't sound like a crocodile or like any snake or lizard Gorge had ever known. It was deeper and somehow colder, as if it came from somewhere hollow down inside the earth. Gorge frowned. "I won't let go," she thought. "This is my prey." "Gorge, I insist." Gorge let go. "What? Why did I do that?" she thought. She watched in shock as the zebra foal thrashed to the surface, gulped in air, and started to clamber unsteadily back up the bank, trailing blood from the tooth marks on its haunch, but very much alive. She tried to swim after it and grab it again, but she couldn't seem to move. Only after it was gone, lost in the vast air above, did she find her tail was back under her control. She spun in the water, snapping at nothing in case the invisible creature was nearby. "What did you make me do that for?"
"We have more important things to do now," came the reply.
Gorge snorted a stream of bubbles from her nose. "More important than eating?"
"Follow me, Gorge," the strange voice went on. "The others are waiting."
Gorge found her gaze fixed upstream, her tail moving slowly, pushing her through the curtains of long reeds. She wasn't sure anymore whether she was being forced to move or whether she was doing it herself. She just knew this was the way she needed to go. At last, she began to see ripples ahead, tails and claws, all gathered along the bank at the far end of the watering hole. The rest of the basque were all there, from Swallow's gang of unruly hatchlings to elderly Crunch, who moved from her comfortable nest so rarely that her hide was slick with growing moss. They were all facing the same direction, their heads up out of the water, as though something on the surface had caught their attention. Gorge swam up beside Feast, half expecting him to turn and greet her, but he was motionless in the water, like he was asleep, or watching a careless grass tongue wander too far from its herd. Gingerly, Gorge raised her head from the water to see what the basque were staring at. But there was nothing there.
"My children," said the voice inside her head, and beside her Feast twitched, and Gorge knew that he'd heard it too. "The time of the sand tongue is here at last. Grandmother needs you."
Gorge stared out with the rest of her kind, her gaze drawn up past the edge of the water, past the bank, past everything she had ever known, until it fixed on the purple shadow of the mountain on the far horizon.
"Your empty bellies do not matter now," said the voice. "Listen to Grandmother, and soon you will feast on all of Bravelands."
Chapter 1.
"Moonflower, grab my hand!"
Bramble reached desperately through the rain for his sister as she slid down the stony slope toward him. Moonflower flailed for him and gripped his arm. He tried to catch and steady her, holding on to a tree branch with his other hand. but her momentum was too strong, and they both went tumbling, rolling down the hill. Bramble held on tight to Moonflower and squeezed his eyes closed, letting out yelps of pain as rocks and roots jabbed into his back and his shoulders. Finally, they slammed into something hard and came to a stop in an ungainly heap against the trunk of a huge tree. Moonflower managed to sit up, turning her face to the wet, black sky and letting out a groan of frustration. "I hate this," she said. Bramble knew just how she felt. He peered around the tree trunk, but it was too dark to see their path down to the plains now. The mountain was almost behind them, the only home they or their ancestors had ever known, but the descent was hard, and there was nothing but wide, empty terror waiting for them at the bottom. Since he was a tiny baby, he'd known the old mantra, "Blood pools on the plains." But there was nothing for them up in the mountain either. When Moonflower spoke again, it was in a small, almost hollow voice. "Do you think? I know you said you saw something, but don't you think if we went back now, there's a chance she could be alive?" Bramble sighed and sat down beside her. What could he say? He was certain that her mother, Dayflower, was dead. He had seen the pain and terror in Dayflower's eyes as she'd been dragged back into the depths of the vents that ran beneath the mountain. He had seen the thing dragging her, scaly coils like a snake, but unimaginably huge. Still, what snake was strong enough to overpower a gorilla? "I'm sorry, but I know what I saw," he said gently. "We can't go back now. If there's even the slightest chance." Moonflower gazed back up the slope that they'd just tripped and scrambled their way down. She opened her mouth to say more, but then froze, her breath catching. "Bramble," came a soft voice from the shadows. Bramble would know that voice anywhere, and sure enough, a moment later he spotted the shadowy shape of Apple Goldback knuckling down the slope toward them.
"And Moonflower, too, thank goodness," Apple said. "I thought you might have hurt yourselves running down here." Her voice was soothing, as calm and loving as it had always been. Bramble swallowed and turned to stand awkwardly, his heart torn between the urge to run toward her and the urge to flee. Apple had always been a source of safety for him, ever since she'd suckled him after her sister's death left him orphaned. Right now, he was bruised and tired and frightened, and Apple was the gorilla who could always make him feel better.
"Burbark wants to apologize, Bramble," Apple said, emerging from the shadow of the tree and stepping closer to the two young gorillas. Bramble saw the beseeching look on her face and her soft, reaching hand, and then he saw the snake bite on her wrist. It looked raw and wet, and not just from the rain that pattered down all around them.
"There's been a misunderstanding," Apple cooed. "If you'll just come back with me, Burbark will make it all right again, I promise."
"Bramble," Moonflower said and grabbed his arm. "Don't listen to her."
"You're the bright back, Bramble," Apple said. "Burbark needs you to return to take your rightful place as his heir. The troop needs you."
Bramble looked down at the muddy ground, feeling the raindrops spatter across the back of his neck. With the troop, it would be warm and safe, and perhaps Apple was telling the truth. Perhaps it was all some awful misunderstanding. Perhaps.
"The troop killed my mother."
Bramble turned to look at Moonflower. She looked back at him with sad eyes.
"You're right.
she added quietly. There's no way she could have survived. And Burbark tried to kill us, too. She turned her gaze back on Apple and her expression hardened. And you watched.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.